What's this fucking thing, Sopranos? What the fuck it is?
These are actual FBI recordings of four men talking about a mob TV show they love. They're discussing whether The Sopranos is based on them. The men belong to a real New Jersey crime family called the DeCavalcantes family. These recordings were later used in court to convict them of murder, racketeering, extortion, illegal gambling, bribery, organized crime.
They would rather break your arm off and beat you to death with your own arm rather than make love to a woman.
He stabbed the guy in the eye with a fork.
Don't fucking move!
Violence and intimidation is why they survive.
Oh, shit!
This is a true story of extreme violence, brutality, and fear. These guys aren't just like the Sopranos. These are the real Sopranos. And this is the intimate tale of their rise and fall. In the TV show The Sopranos, Tony Soprano is the head of a modern mob family. Violent, brutal, and ruthless. But there's something that's different about his family. Until The Sopranos came along, the mob had always been a New York thing. The show established the idea of the small-town mobster living in the epitome of suburbia, New Jersey.
Yeah, it was cool.
But there was a real New Jersey crime family before The Sopranos. The DeCavalcantes family were based on the wrong side of the Hudson River. They were the smallest and oldest mob family in America. They called themselves the Jersey Mob. The world now knows them as the Real Sopranos.
Whoever the scriptwriters have listened or read the tapes of actual conversations by mafiosi, and they know that every other word is laced with profanity.
No fucking way.
So in the mob vernacular,
you piece of shit!
Profanity serves both as a noun and a verb.
Fuck all of them.
An adjective, an adverb.
Open the fucking door. Open the fucking door!
It's every part of grammar.
The similarities between the Sopranos and the real New Jersey mob don't stop at the way they speak. Both families hung out at a pork store, and the fictional Santanis is less than 200 yards from Sacco's, where the real mob could be found most mornings.
You can walk around the corner. You can go to the real gangster pork store and then walk down the street and go to the TV pork store.
Tony Soprano reveals his caring side when underboss Jackie Aprile dies of stomach cancer. In 1992, real DeCavalcantes underboss Jake Amari died of stomach cancer. But in the real New Jersey crime family, there was one man who could claim the most unbelievable parallels with the fictional New Jersey crime family. Vinnie Palermo, known as Vinnie Ocean, has the strongest claim to be the real Tony Soprano. Tony Soprano owns a strip club, the Bada Bing. Vinnie Ocean owned Wiggles, a strip club in Queens. Tony and Vinnie are both capos. Both their crews are murderous and often incompetent. Tony Soprano lives in a mini mansion. Vinnie Ocean lived in this mini mansion. Both Tony and Vinnie take over their family without officially becoming boss. And both of them have trouble spelled with a capital FBI.
What's going on? What are you doing?
The world of the real Tony Soprano, Vinnie Palermo, was just as brutal and sometimes funnier than fiction.
All right, we'll go to Plan B. I'll talk to you later.
And the mob isn't a career you retire from. For both men, there's only three ways it can end.
You either die, you go away, or you cooperate. There's really no other way out of it.
The rise and fall of Vinnie Ocean began in 1989. The DeCavalcantes were what they had always been, the poor relations of the New York Mafia.
If you listen to Bruce Springsteen, he'll tell you everything you need to know about New Jersey. New Jersey is the place you want to get out of, and you aspire to come to New York. It's the place next to power. It's the place next to money. It's the place next to celebrity.
No one took them seriously.
If you asked anybody who was in the five families in New York, I don't think they'd want to be a member of the Jersey mob. I actually know of some cases where, you know, guys couldn't get made in New York and had to, as a last resort, take Jersey.
The New York families look at the New Jersey family as a pathetic stepchild. The New York families call them farmers, and they really hate that.
They were a branch office of the American Mafia, and they didn't like it. But this was the family Vinnie Paloma was trying to get into. He started at the bottom.
He got his nickname because he at one point was involved in selling fish at the Fulton Fish Market, so they came up with the brilliant nickname Vinnie Ocean.
Vinnie wasn't just working the fish market, he was hustling, and he'd married into the mob, the daughter of the underboss of the Real Soprano family.
I think he was street smart and willing to do things that other people were not willing to do. He was also able to kind of see other people's weaknesses. He's a very corporate guy, basically. You know, he would have been a great CEO.
It was that willingness that got Vinnie Ocean his big chance. It was time for him to make his bones. In 1989, John Gotti, the biggest boss in the New York Mafia, wanted the Jersey mob to do him a favor.
This is very important for our family. It'll give us some credence, make us look good with the other five families.
John Gotti always kind of looked at the DeCavalcanti family as a Jersey mall or something. And so Gotti reached out to the DeCavalcanti family, the farmers, and asked them to do a little piece of work, that's the phrase they use, to basically shoot this guy who was a real estate developer in Staten Island.
The developer's name was Fred Weiss. It was a Sunday morning, 1989. Four cars drove in convoy over the bridge to Staten Island. Vinny was one of a crew of 12 men staking out Fred Weiss's house.
He comes walking out of his house on a September morning, September 11th, 1989, and he comes walking out of his door, and two guys walk up and shoot him in the face.
Vincent Palermo and James Gallo jumped back in the car. James said, go, 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 so I pulled away, not too fast, not too slow.
And that was a big deal because that was doing a favor for John Gotti. Therefore, Vinnie Palermo could do no wrong in the DeCavalcanti family from then on.
A few days later, Vinnie Ocean became a made man in the DeCavalcanti family.
When you were a member of the Cavalcanti family, you had no choice about being second banana or in second place to the New York families.
But that was about to change. For Vinnie Ocean and the Real Sopranos, the 1990s would be a time of murder, extortion, and vast quantities of cash. In The Sopranos, Tony lives the high life, always flush with cash provided in brown envelopes by the men in his crew.
Mom wanted.
This is lifted directly from the real-life mob. Vinnie Ocean, the real Tony Soprano, became a made man in the Jersey mob after the Staten Island hit. Now he, too, was part of that money-making machine.
Getting into the family was as hard as getting into the most exclusive country club in America. It was an honor, not easily bestowed.
Organized crime is organized. Vinnie was joining a carefully structured business.
You have a boss, you have an underboss, you have a consigliere, and that would be called the administration of the family, the three highest people in the family.
The boss was the only one who could appoint the capos. The capos were people, captains, who controlled the real working crews or units. Each capo had at least 10 people who were known as soldiers. People who were formerly and underwent the blood induction into the family.
Vinny was now a soldier, a made man. He had taken an oath never to reveal the family secrets on pain of death. He'd moved up a rung from being an associate.
You start off as an associate, and if you're a great earner, or if you're somebody that they can depend on to do dirty work that they need, you know, it's gonna push your chances up to become a member.
In the modern mob, it's all about cash flow. Associates have to kick money up to soldiers, soldiers to capos, and capos to the administration. Vinny was given his own scams to run, his to make as much cash as he could from, as long as he kicked some of it upstairs. These were the classic mob schemes, money lending and illegal betting.
As long as there's gambling and loan sharking, the Mafia will be alive and well.
Frank Santasola spent 20 years as a cop infiltrating organized crime. He knows better than anyone else how mob scams work, because he's done them himself.
This is the Park Hill section of Yonkers, South Yonkers. There used to be a club here, right here. I used to turn in work. This was a certain guy's club. Now, I don't know if it's still in operation, but I also used to buy homemade wine in the basement.
Frank was working as a numbers runner, the bottom of the mob hierarchy. Most of Vinny Ocean's crew ran some sort of gambling operation.
It's changed, you know. It's not what it used to be.
The numbers was the unofficial mob lottery. People would bet on what three numbers would come up as the total gambled at the Brooklyn racecourse.
Different outfits have different payouts. Like the outfit I worked for, they were paying 550 to one. People love to gamble. Now, you didn't have to twist their arms. Everybody gambles.
Anyone who knows anything about gambling in America would prefer a wager with the mob. They give you the best odds. There's no taxes.
A lot of guys who gamble end up borrowing money. And if they can't go to the bank and say, I want to gamble $450,000. So what you do is you go to Vinny. And they say, yeah, no problem. I'll give you this money. Okay, no problem. And then you gamble it. And what happens? You lose.
Fucking unbelievable.
Just like Tony Soprano, Vinny Ocean put money out on the street at jaw-clenchingly high rates of interest.
You run from me, you fucking cocksucker? Where's my fucking money?
Say you borrowed $500. So, you know, it's like if I borrowed five, I'd have to pay eight back. So could you imagine if I borrowed five and I could not pay the principal back, and I'd have to come up with $300 a week to give you every week?
You prick! Where's my fucking money?
The Sopranos portrays a world where violence is the simple solution to every problem. That's just as true of the real mob.
For most of the 20th century, the mob was an invisible government and presence in the New York metropolitan area, including New Jersey and Connecticut and Long Island. And they were into everything. The DeCavalcantes controlled one of the important laborers' unions in the construction industry.
They were involved in drug dealing. They extorted stores, auto crimes, medical fraud, insurance fraud, bank burglaries, murder, assaults. You name it, if there was money in it, they found a way to turn it into something.
The alleged members of the Colombo crime family were indicted for loan sharking, labor corruption, extortion.
The 90s was a good time for the Jersey mob. The FBI had hit the New York families hard, taking them down one by one in a series of huge cases. But the real Sopranos continued to fly under the radar.
They live basically two lives. They have their little suburban scene going on with wives and kids, and then they also have their social club thing going on where everybody's hanging out and paying no attention to their family and scheming and making money and gambling and having a good time with their girlfriends.
And of all the members of the DeCavalcante family, Vinny Ocean was having the best time of all.
He was living upper middle class, Long Island existence with a wife, two kids who go to private school, and they would go to Disney World once a year.
Vinny had a unique money-making enterprise. a main supply of clean cash. Wiggles. Yes, just like Tony, the real Sopranos owned a strip club.
Is all nude club? We're not serving alcohol and girls dancing nude on stage. Thursday, Fridays, and Saturdays, that's where the big crowd is. And girls dance nude on stage, so that's the best thing you can see.
And Wiggles was his wonderful source of what he called legitimate money. It was a perfect place. It was a cash business.
Wiggles was meant to be Vinny's source of legitimate cash, but all it brought him was problems with the law. The new mayor of New York, also an Italian-American, wanted to clean up the city, and he wanted to start right here on Queens Boulevard.
Rudy Giuliani decided that it was a really bad idea to have strip clubs in neighborhoods. So they had come up with a law that would essentially eliminate any strip club that was within 500 feet of schools and churches.
He had a lot of problems because they were trying to close down the nude bars. He was just incensed about it. Didn't they have better things to do with their time?
The strip clubs claimed they were just enjoying their constitutional rights to freedom of speech. The city came up with a rule called 60-40.
60-40 is a strange rule. If more than 60% of your business is a strip club, then you're a strip club and you can't exist within 500 feet of a church. But if just a little bit more, a little less than 40% is a strip club, you're all set. You're not really a strip club.
The 60% of the club is empty right now.
The 60-40 trick enabled Wiggles to stay open, but it was still the constant subject of police attention.
It's funny how that's an assignment that a lot of the officers really seem to covet. But they send in undercover officers to see if it's really a strip club, which is a really tough assignment. And they would kind of see what was offered in the VIP room.
Some people talk to the girls, some people sniffing them hair for 15 minutes, and some people enjoying the dance, you know, watching girls dancing in front of them, and a little lap dance.
Wiggles is still open today, under new management. But there was one thing even more important than cash: respect. On TV, Tony Soprano was prepared to kill his oldest friend over a matter of respect. It was even more true for the real Sopranos, a mob family with a collective inferiority complex, terrified that New York didn't give them the respect they deserved.
They cultivate an image of cool guys. That's how they recruit. It's not, you know, I mean, can you imagine that you'd be able to walk around a neighborhood in Brooklyn and say, hey, let's all become heroin dealers. That doesn't really work, even though they're heroin dealers.
The Jersey mob's inferiority complex had a body count, and that gave Vinny his chance to step up to the very top.
Those guys were sociopaths. They would rather break your arm off and beat you to death with your own arm rather than make love to a woman. I noticed. And you know, it used to concern me because I used to drink with them, eat with them, you know, party with them, weddings, wakes, funerals.
The Jersey mob were prepared to murder their own acting boss, John D'Amato, to protect the family honor. D'Amato's girlfriend let something slip to another member of the family, Anthony Capo.
She told me John D'Amato and her were going to sex clubs in the city and swapping partners, and that John was engaged in homosexual activities. It shocked me. I knew John for a long time. He was the boss of an organized crime family.
Thank you.
He couldn't be acting that way.
Anthony felt he just had to tell other people about this, because supposedly the mafia has a rule which says you can't be gay and be in the mafia.
I've met Anthony Capo once. He came down from his house in a bathrobe and looked like he was snorting his brains out all night. That's the impression I got of him, is just a coked up guy.
He is sort of the psycho you go to when you need to get money from somebody. The guy owes you money, have Anthony go talk to the guy with a baseball bat.
He called a meeting of the capos, and it was decided that for the sake of the family honor, D'Amato had to die.
Nobody's going to respect us if we have a gay homosexual boss sitting down and discussing Cosa Nostra business with other families.
I don't think any family would be too pleased to hear that their boss was actually found in a gay bar. I don't think that would go over too well at all.
A car was waiting outside D'Amato's house. D'Amato came out and got in. Capo turned and shot him twice in the face.
They shot him in the back of a car and drove him to a garage and rolled him up in a rug and sent him upstate.
Word gets back in 2 seconds. You know, you guy like that gets killed, you know, you're gonna find out about it real quick. And the rumors are gonna fly on who you think did it.
As with most mob hits, they got away with it.
Most of them a pretty clean job. You probably know exactly who did it, but in order to prove a murder case, you know, you need evidence, corroboration.
With D'Amato dead, the family decided not to appoint a new boss. Instead, they appointed 3 capos to run the family. One of these men was Vinnie Ocean. Vinnie had reached the top of the mob. He was a rich man. But the icing on the cake for the Real Sopranos was yet to come. It was 1998 and a new TV show hit the screens. The story of a New Jersey crime family.
The Sopranos.
Perfect.
Thank you.
It was the biggest audience and critical hit of the year. Above all, when The Sopranos hit the screen, it put the New Jersey mob on the map.
The Sopranos made the DeCavalcantes famous. Nobody knew about them before. So the Sopranos, in effect, were a terrific public relations boost for the DeCavalcantes and gave them some kind of aura of pride, something they never had before.
You're doing an excellent
The real Jersey mob would take a break from extorting construction sites to watch the Sopranos do the same thing. And they loved it.
It kind of gave them this almost romantic aura. They're TV stars. That's the way they act about the thing. They talk about it as if, of course, they make a TV show about us.
So you know this neighborhood good, huh?
A lot of these guys are barely making a living. And when they see something like this on TV, they feel much better about themselves.
I think that they were thoroughly entertained by it. It's like anything else. They felt the thrill of being not imitated, but portrayed.
Tony Soprano and the Bada Bing might look like they were based on Vinnie Ocean and Wiggles, but the creators of the TV show insisted they hadn't copied the real Jersey mob. In fact, they did a PR job on them. The Sopranos made the real mob seem more successful than they were.
The Sopranos is good entertainment, but it's terrible history. It's lousy facts. Anyone in the mob who lived the lifestyle of Tony Soprano wouldn't last one day. He begins his day by walking out of his mini mansion in his bathrobe. He walks down to pick up his newspaper. He's totally exposed. If anyone wanted to hit him or whack him, they could. All the mobsters that I've met in my lifetime, I've never met anybody that was a good guy. All they're interested in is their own self-survival, making money, and if necessary, murdering everybody in their path. Soprano is not your typical mobster.
And in a bizarre mingling of fact and fiction, the Sopranos would play a role in the downfall of the real Jersey mob. On TV, it's a source of dramatic tension. The FBI are watching the Sopranos. In the real world, FBI surveillance tapes show the DeCavalcantes comparing themselves to Soprano characters, and this would damn them when they eventually came to trial.
So what you have is a kind of art imitates life, imitates art. And you have gangsters sitting around watching in the Sopranos and learning from them and imitating them.
one of the arguments was, you know, the government can't prove that they're a crime family. And I said, what are you kidding? They've compared themselves to a make-believe crime family.
Vinny Ocean and the Jersey Mob thought they were untouchable, but the show they loved would make them famous in all the wrong ways. The Real Sopranos were about to find themselves top of everybody's hit list.
Hey, there they are.
On TV, the FBI are always on Tony Soprano's case. Their dream scenario is to flip one of his men. Big Pussy is a central figure in Tony's tightly knit crew, but with a drugs charge hanging over him, there's nothing else he can do. He agrees to wear a wire. With the fictional New Jersey mob making the headlines, the FBI were forced to do something about the Real Sopranos. Their number one target was acting boss Vinny Ocean.
At the end of the day, you need a break. You need somebody who's going to do more than just offer you confidential information. You need somebody who's willing to make tapes.
Maria got her break and Vinny met his nemesis in the unlikely shape of a man called Ralphie Guarino.
He was a short guy, medium build, salt and pepper hair, impeccably dressed, you know, a little bit of an olive complexion, had to talk.
Ralphie was a gambler. He is basically not a tough guy. He's not going to go around killing people. But what he's going to do is he's going to have his schemes. And this guy's like lives to scheme. He schemes the way I dream.
Ralphie's big scam was a delivery of cash coming to the World Trade Center on the 13th of January 1998. The security van with the money arrived in the underground car park at 11 a.m. Two guards put bags of money on a trolley and took the lift to the 11th floor.
We'd pull some guns out, grab these bags that were being transported by bank employees, and take the elevator down and get out of the building with bags of cash.
They walked out of the building with $3 million in bags, as nonchalant as you like.
As the elevator doors opened on the 11th floor...
But the heist didn't go exactly as planned. As Ralphie later put it, the three guys he chose for the job turned out to be morons.
They forgot that there were cameras all over the place. And in one particularly beautiful moment, they looked right up into the camera, which ended up on the front page of just about every newspaper the next morning. I don't know, within days they had all of them.
They got off the lift at the wrong floor. Even worse, they'd taken foreign currency, useless to Ralphie.
It was very amusing to the general New York population because here they were, they wore all these ski masks and they covered themselves up and then they went out in the hallway, took everything off and whoosh.
The robbery was linked back to Ralphie almost immediately. A senior FBI agent turned up at his house and offered him one chance to stay out of jail.
He was able to talk him through it and basically laid the cards on the table and said, here are your options, and you're doing yourself a lot of good and everybody else a lot of good if you, you know, join Team America. And he did. He persuaded him.
That's what it takes.
So what we did was, rather than make a big publicity, we just recovered the money and we kept it quiet.
Ralphie was now a rat. His job was to wear a wire and get close to Vinny Ocean.
If somebody suspects you and they do realize that you're taping them, you know, you're gonna get killed.
There'd be some occasions where I would wear a wire.
Ralphie was shown how to tape his friends. Frank Santasola is one of only a handful of cops who have ever infiltrated the mob.
I tape it to my chest between my... in the breast area by the solar plexus because it's indented there. And, these guys are pretty smart. They're always bumping into you for a reason, to find out if you're wired. So there's a few ways of doing it. You know, and as you're doing this, for me, going through my mind is, my mission
I knew that I had an hour and a half of recording time. So whatever information, I had to get it within that hour and a half, and that's plenty of time. So you hit the record button, you see the red light go on, so now you know it's recording. And then I always would say to myself, you know, I saw the red light. Because you know what? Emotions come into it. And you, sometimes your mind plays tricks on you. Did I put it on? Didn't I put it on? Now I know it's on. And now I'm live, I'm ready to go. Nobody's gonna... I look natural, right?
Just like Frank, even once he got on the inside, Ralphie would never be sure he was safe.
I remember walking into the social club, and there was no movement, and everybody's somber. So I walk up to the bar, and this guy Frank goes, "Hey, Cheech, we know you're a cop. Now we want you to take this money and get the fuck out of here." You know, you got to sort of like think pretty quick. So I went to grab the money, and as I'm grabbing it, I'm saying, "Well, I know you think I'm a cop. I ain't, but I'm taking your money." And the guy puts his hand on mine, and he says, "Look, Cheech, we just have to, you know, we just got to make sure. We just got to make sure." This was the bar, right here.
When did they flip you? Tell me. Don't lie. Flip?
Ralphie had plenty to fear. The way the Sopranos dealt with their rat was realistic enough. No one saw the FBI visit Ralphie at home. As far as the family was concerned, he was a guy who had just pulled off a massive heist. And that made him welcome in the Jersey mob. Ralphie Guarino became the newest member of Vinnie Ocean's crew.
Ralphie comes into the family because he's making money. It's always about money. Forget the rest of the stuff. Forget about honorable guys and all this. It's about money. It's a business.
Ralphie was put with Vinnie's driver, Joey Masella, known as Joey O.
Joey was really a poor schmuck. He was an errand boy, collecting large amounts of money for Vinnie Palermo.
Most guys in the modern mob were more like Joey than Vinnie, scratching a living from disorganized crime. They managed to combine extreme violence with comical incompetence. A guy like Ralphie looked to Vinnie like a godsend.
How could they not have known that Ralphie would possibly become an informant after his genius scheme exploded onto the front page of every newspaper in New York? It's hard to know, except I would point out that Ralphie kept bringing the money in, and as long as that money's coming in, the incentive to just put, you know, whack somebody, it's just not there.
Joey, on the other hand, had debts up to his eyeballs. Problems with his wife, problems with his ex-wife, problems with his girlfriend. He was one screw up away from some serious trouble.
He was trying to run his own gambling business, and he had terrible luck, always. I mean, running an illegal gambling business is very, very stressful. You gotta pay off your bets, and if you don't have money, and if you haven't calculated correctly, you're always owing money, and it's a huge problem.
He is always desperate for cash, and constantly trying to come up with ways to make money.
Joey had been waiting half a lifetime to become a made man. Finally, Vinny gave him his chance. Vinny wanted his rival, Big Ears Charlie Maggiore, dead. Maggiore lived with his mother in this house in Linden, New Jersey.
At the point that you're asked to do it, you basically have two options. Do it, or you better turn yourself in somewhere, because it's not as if you have any other choice.
Are you sure we got the right house?
I hope so.
Hey.
They spent hours parked in front of this guy's house, trying to figure out how they could get him when he's coming out.
Killing Big Ears would get Joey back in the family's favor. Instead, he achieved nothing.
The guys he was with didn't really seem to have much of a plan. It was pretty much go up to the door. If he answers it, we'll shoot him sort of thing.
Who gives a shit if he lives with a mother or not?
I'm just worried about the guy across the street. The cop's gonna come, then what?
They spent hours till they realized that there was a state trooper like parked like next door who happened to live next door. I figured that probably might not be a good place to do that.
Fuck it, you guys got nothing to do anyway.
Finally, they just like all gave up and drove off, and that was the end of it. And Joey Mazzella flew down to Florida, and he just said, I'm not doing this. This is just, you got to set it up better than this.
And that was Joey's big chance to be a made guy, gone.
But you have to ask yourself this question. Have you ever shot anybody? What's it like? How do you do it? How do you do it right? You go to school to learn how to do that?
Joey went back to his version of everyday life. This is the business end of organized crime. Two guys in a car driving around trying to think of ways to make money. Ralphie had to keep Joey thinking he was another guy looking out for a scam. The FBI would create scenarios for him, plant jewelry or other valuables for him to pretend to steal.
You pretend you have stolen property. What you do is when you do make recoveries of stolen property, you use it to set it up and you offer to sell it.
All the time, Ralphie was pumping Joey for information. What he and his handlers were getting was a picture of criminal incompetence.
One of the things that happens with FBI tapes is they're supposed to turn the tape recorder off when people start talking about personal stuff. They don't. They leave it on all the time.
Most of the talking is really boring because it's mostly, how are we going to make money? Who's making money? Well, how can we get a piece of that?
So far, no one suspected Ralphie wasn't what he seemed, least of all his boss, Vinny Ocean. It was Joey who was getting himself into deeper and deeper trouble. The Jersey mob could come over like the Keystone Cops, but these clowns packed real guns.
I can't imagine what it would be like to get up every single morning thinking that some psychotic guy I owe $450,000 to could be parked outside my door.
Hold on a minute. I'll call you back.
He owed lots of money to people, and he owed money to people that were in other families. And whenever there's an issue about that, then the person that they're going to go to with their beef is your boss.
Fuck out of here.
Vinny had had enough. He told Joey he should have him killed.
I'm fucking done with you.
It's probably not the best idea to kill somebody who owes you money. Because probably, if you don't kill him, they'll pay you something, so you'll at least have some money coming in. In his case, I think he became kind of an embarrassment.
It was October the 10th, 1998. Joey got a call from a bookmaker who owed him money to say he'd got $10,000 for him.
He was called to a golf course way out in Brooklyn.
They lured him out to a parking place.
And somebody just pulled up and blew him away. And that was the end of Joey O. They were all trying to kill each other because everybody thought everybody else was becoming an informant.
Of course, there was an informant. The FBI were listening all along, but they weren't getting what they needed. They didn't have evidence linking Vinny Ocean to the crimes his crew was committing.
You can't go to victims. No victim wants to come in, and they'd rather pay the loan sharking debt.
They used a tactic that had worked before.
Who is this piece of shit?
Vinny Palermo and money. And so our cooperator offered him a cell phone, said, I've got this connection, and take it in as many minutes as you want. And that was the cell phone we had bought.
After Joey was killed, Ralphie was put with Tinius Sclafani, a gangster of the old school.
Joe Tin Ear Sclafani, so named because he's deaf in one ear, was a former Marine who is a tough guy. He's the guy that pulls the trigger.
Tin Ear might have been more frightening than Joey O, but he was just as incompetent. He wanted Ralphie's help with a hit.
He was another, I mean, we always got stuck with people who were not very productive financially. He was always looking for things to do. And so one of the things that we investigated was that Sclafani had agreed to take the hit, and he was trying to get at him. And Sclafani was obsessed with trying to kill the guy on a motorcycle, but he didn't know how to drive a motorcycle. And it was just like these endless conversations about getting a motorcycle and how he and our cooperator were going to ride on it and what they were going to do.
Other members of the crew were starting to suspect that Ralphie might be the rat after all. These were guys with a stack of bodies between them. They ordered a hit on him.
We began to worry that they were suspicious of him. We were worried about the safety of our cooperating witness. We were worried about whether or not Vinnie Palermo would flee.
The FBI was closing in on Vinnie Ocean. Ralphie's grave had already been dug. But the Real Sopranos case was about to take a turn unprecedented in the history of the mob.
FBI, open up!
In The Sopranos, Tony is always waiting for that unwelcome knock at the door.
DeCavalcanti crime family is one of the oldest and most entrenched crime families in the La Costa Nostra.
On the 2nd of December 1999, the police and the FBI arrested 40 members of the DeCavalcanti crime family in the biggest ever swoop on the mob. The press called it the Real Sopranos case. Vinnie Ocean, the real Tony Soprano, first thought about flight.
On the day of the arrest, Vinnie Palermo was found under circumstances that would indicate he was leaving home.
The day that we were supposed to take down the first case, I think 6 or 7 of the top defendants weren't home.
He had a bag with him and money with him, and he was, you know, he clearly was ready to take off.
But Vinnie didn't get away. Like the rest of the family, he found himself in jail. The FBI had come for the DeCavalcantes, just like the five families in New York they tried to emulate.
They effectively brought the whole family down, and they arrested almost everybody, which is kind of unprecedented.
Vinnie was facing serious jail time.
They included murder conspiracies, loan sharking, extortion, fraud, the interstate transportation of stolen property, all manner of charges. It was a very strong case, and there were very strong charges. When you're facing that, the stronger the charges, the more difficult it is to roll the dice.
Vinnie Ocean was on the ruling committee of a mob family. He was meant to be a man of honor, to go down and do his time. But Vinnie Ocean wasn't entirely happy with that option.
For somebody like Vinnie Palermo, who led a nice life and who had a business that he enjoyed and liked the legitimacy of being a business guy, and, you know, it's a very hard thing to then settle into prison for life.
Vinnie's lawyer did a deal with the prosecutors. Vincent Vinnie Ocean Palermo agreed to cooperate. He flipped. And once Vinnie had flipped, the floodgates were open.
You couldn't put the number of informants that came out of that case on a school bus. You couldn't fit them. There were so many of them. They were rushing to get in there. Everybody was trying to get their deal as fast as possible.
A few old-timers like Tinia Sclafani chose to do their time, but something fundamental had changed in the mob.
Don't forget, years ago, guys went into that life because they really had nothing else. If they went to jail, sometimes it was almost an improvement. Today, a lot of these kids who become made guys are driving their father's brand new car at 15 years old, grow up in a $1 million house. Of course, when you throw them in a cell, they're going to cooperate. They've never been tested, and they've really been pampered most of their life.
It was the end of the line for the DeCavalcanti family. The Jersey mob thought they were the real Sopranos. They aspired to be on the same level as the New York families, and they blew it.
Listen, you look at a guy like John Gotti. Whatever he was, whatever he wasn't, You got to give the guy a little bit of credit because he was really treated like the lowest form of dirt in prison, and he never broke. You admire that kind of quality in somebody because he backed up what he said.
The end game would play out very differently for Vinny Ocean.
Well, Vinny Palermo ends up in WITSEC, the Witness Protection Program. He'll move in next to you. He'll become your neighbor. You have no idea who he is. He has a new name. His name is not Vinny Palermo. I'm sure he doesn't, you know, go by the name Vinny Ocean when he moves into some suburb in Phoenix.
The best days of the mob were well and truly over.
Tony Soprano is always thinking about the good old days when he thought that mafiosi were more Spartan, they were more loyal, they obeyed the oaths of omerta, of how to conduct themselves as men of honor.
But the so-called men of honor broke even their own rules.
May I burn in hell?
I betray my friends.
In real life, they know that they're being watched. Getting their pictures taken. They gotta watch that their phones aren't tapped. They gotta watch that the club that they hang in it isn't bugged. They gotta be afraid now if the guy they're talking to is wearing a wire on them.
They're absolutely paranoid, but you have to be.
There is no way they're as powerful today as they was, say, 30, 40, 20 years ago. Today, they're lucky they can get a reservation at a restaurant, you know? Really, literally.
The mob looks finished as a viable career option. But as one opportunity ends, another one begins. Tony Sirico, the actor on the left, is convincing his Paulie Walnuts for a reason. Before he became an actor, Sirico was arrested 28 times and jailed for 7 years.
Let's whack this cocksucker and be done with it.
He limps because he was shot. The kind of guys who used to join the mob now play mobsters on The Sopranos. While the real Jersey mob do their time or hide away in witness protection, there's one mafia family that's alive and well and living in New Jersey, for now. The Sopranos.